Ison and Moina had lived parallel lives since their tender youths, and yet they did not know each other personally. There were 2 years between them, and he went to a boys' school and she to another school that was solely for girls and that was separated by a wall. There was such a vast number of children on either side of the wall that it was unlikely that they would meet, despite being so close. When I say a wall, I do not imply it figuratively. The girls' school was on an upper level. The wall was about 10 meters high and the boys' school was beneath it. They grew up on either side of this wall without meeting. They even had friends in common, but still they did not meet. Unai was one of Ison's friends and he had a sister who showed an interest in Ison, and as she was a friend of Moina's she must have told her, but Moina must not have taken any notice. Ison would be just one more person in the darkness of Madrid in the early 70s. Yet for Moina this must have been the first time that she became aware of Ison's existence, but it would not be the last. In these circumstances it could be said that Ison and Moina lived parallel lives, almost bonded, but separated by a wall in time, and almost together in space. Two people can live virtually hand in hand, even 10 meters apart, and not see each other. For two people to meet, time is essential. For the eyes of two people to cross, they must have found each other in space and time. Even though both are born at almost the same time and study almost side by side, they must coincide in both space and time. Although space is made up of three dimensions, it can be simplified into one. There would therefore be two variables, space and time. In the case of Moina and Ison, despite being very close, this did not result in them catching each other's eye. Life at school was arduous for them both. They did not know that society outside of the walls was hard, and so, even though the two of them lived well, they complained for no reason. They both had excellent relationships with their classmates, but they kept their distance. They were intelligent and envy is never far away. Besides, they wished to exceed their classmates, and they did. Even so, everything that surrounded the world of Ison and Moina was repulsive. Everything was designed so that they would continue this type of life that seemed predetermined by destiny, which was ultimately a deceit. It was all an embellishment that was dressed and removed as if it were a macabre game. In fact, they would both feel a sense of belonging. Then they briefly conversed with a beggar, a policeman, or some kind-hearted bandit, far removed from that world where they were figures in a picture-perfect family. Their parents were concerned with them being the best, as were the school priests and nuns, but at the slightest failure they were thrown aside like a pair of rag dolls. Their fathers, the priests and the nuns that guided Ison and Moina's destinies, were sheer bureaucrats and economists with little sensitivity, and from whom they could hope for nothing. Only their mothers escaped. Even a large part of their extended families were a bunch of fools, but they could not be wholly blamed, as they too had enough to endure, and so Ison and Moina could not hope for anything from them either. These family members had a part to play in the story, just as Ison and Moina did, in spite of not being fully aware of it. Time passed, sometimes quickly and sometimes slowly. The school years went by swiftly, one after the other, on one side of the wall as much as on the other. Neither Ison nor Moina had problems throughout the school years, but they wished to leave the school walls behind them and discover what was beyond. It could be said that they spent 10 years side by side, but that nothing could foretell an encounter. Statistically, though, there were possibilities of them meeting. Ison played defense quite well and was able to play in the team that he had looked up to since he was young. This was a great stroke of luck. Fighting against the opponent in the right way is a bomb against loneliness and is character building. He had a lot of responsibility in his team. If you play with the team that you have dreamt of since you were a 5-year-old child, people start to see you as a dreamer that has achieved their dream. These types of dreams are dangerous. As a 5-year-old, you dream of reaching there. But when you arrive, it is like you lose your mind. People expect a lot from you, but they still do not forgive you for your mistakes. Indeed, coming second in the school league was a rung below best. People did not forgive Ison for this. It seemed as though losing a simple match, even if it was the final, would drive the people to consider Ison a loser in free fall. They did not value what it had cost him to get there. The people only valued him for a simple 90-minute-long match. Back to the topic of Ison's dream to play with his team. Ison wasn't very disciplined, and so sometimes he would miss training. Although people think that those that make it are all very strong, the truth is that they are mistaken. Many leave sport out of laziness, to follow other aspirations, or simply because they are tired of it. In fact, throughout his life, Ison met a lot of people that this had happened to. As a matter of fact, starting to leave that door open prefigured the start of Ison's free fall. Contrary to the belief of many, your life can change in a second. Nonetheless, the good time that he had when he was included in the team was priceless, because sometimes this was indispensable in order to win matches. And that more than made up for it all. Be that as it may, this sporting experience changed something in Ison, and since those days he began to search for new aims and to close the book on that which he had finished, as he considered that his sporting goal had been accomplished. Now he would have to look for new challenges. He was popular, and so was she. They were both born to wealthy parents, but not out of love. They lived well in the Madrid of the 80s, which was the epicenter of the so-called movida madrileña, a countercultural movement. The only problem that they had was deciding which party or nightclub to go to, and if they did not have money, they went to a park to drink. Life at that time was different. People smoked on airplanes and trains. Nobody even considered buying condoms unless it was strictly necessary. The movida madrileña was something that came out of nowhere, the ball that began to roll, and then inexplicably tumbled. People lived well in those times. It must be said that you could enjoy the environment. It was like being on a Polynesian desert island after having eaten with your family on a Sunday. There were many coincidences between Ison and Moina's family lives. They both had strict families, and this propelled them out onto the street in search of happiness. Ison and Moina were anxious to leave their homes, like crazy people, without caring where they went. They only looked to disappear for a few hours away from their houses. In Ison's case, looking for new challenges as he desired to find new experiences, although in those years such experiences had been intense. It was under these special circumstances that the first meeting took place. Curiously enough, it was close to the wall that had separated them for all those years. The first meeting was going to happen, whether somebody forced the situation or whether statistically it had to happen, we do not know. ISON was heading towards one of the many parties that took place throughout the summers of the 80s. It was in a classy neighborhood, and when he left an ice cream shop he heard the voice behind him say, "ISON, can I come with you?" It was an attractive girl, a little younger than him, and ISON said yes. In that moment Ison's heart fluttered in a way that he had never felt before. He noticed her green eyes that he would never forget, and on her wrist he saw a mark. That mark could well have been a scar from having tried to cut her veins the night before. She was what was considered in those times to be a well-off girl, and although Ison supposed that she was one of the girls from the school next door, it did not even cross his mind to think that she might be Yunei's sister's friend. Ison realized straight away that their lives had crossed. If you fix your gaze on someone for more than 1 second and you are attracted to that person, then the memory stays with you forever. In spite of the image that they gave off, the small slip in the nauseating lives that they both lived could result in either of them cutting their veins in order to escape the continuous circle of lies that filled their lives. Ison could not shed off the image of the scar on Moina's wrist. Nonetheless, his life had other worlds. Both of their thoughts drifted towards something which Ison sensed was love. They were both still very young. They had their whole lives in front of them, and in those moments they only had to enjoy. There were moments in which they had everything. In the instant just before their encounter, Ison was thinking that he would never fall in love. "What for if I have all the friends that I want?" he thought, given that at that time he had many female friends and he didn't pay much attention to love in its greater sense. In fact, he worried, thinking that if she had not said, "Can I come with you?" the time would probably have passed. Their paths would not have crossed, and he would never have experienced the feeling. However, there are things that have to happen and that happen. Something or someone could have forced the situation for this to happen. However it may be, in Ison's case it was irreversible. That impenetrable moment having passed, Ison noticed the neon green sign that hung from the door of the ice cream shop where they had met. And they continued to walk towards the nightclub. But once Ison disappeared, doubtless one of his many friends claimed him. He understood then that Moina was highly sought after in Madrid. Every heartless man wanted to be with her, if only for the standing that she had. As a matter of fact, Ison thought, "I have fallen in love with one of the most popular girls, and I'm going to have a lot of competition." Because she was a free spirit that would fit in better in a Kathmandu sunset than in Madrid. She complicated life by being free. There was something special about 80s Madrid. Such as when Ison, who was reclined against the windscreen of the car, saw her appear and solemnly drink up the moon rays, bathing in them at 1 o'clock in the morning on a towel on the pavement. Ison was totally settled in a comfortable position with his back against the windscreen and his legs on the car bonnet. And then he burst out laughing. He thought, "What a magical night. Leaning here listening to music on a hot summer night in Madrid, having left my favorite club." Then Moina, after hesitating for a moment as if analyzing the situation, looked at him critically for a moment, as if to say, "What an arsehole you are." Perhaps it was because she thought that he was laughing at her. The truth was that he laughed with her. It was a comic situation that had brightened up Ison's night even more. If that is possible, he admired her for being someone so free within the Madrid that was sometimes so inhospitable. This traumatized Ison, Life was not perfect and everything could change in a second. She could go with somebody else, abandon him, or worse. The human brain sometimes goes over and over the same thing, analyzing millions of variables in a second. It does so on impulses and decides whether the feeling is real or not. In fact, Tyson thought that being in a relationship had only a 30% chance of success. But he didn't care. There was something about Moina that told him she was as crazy as he. Indeed, they met because it was one of those typical days. Then they both left their houses with the same aim, to avoid the problems that they had at home. Tyson had a good time knowing that he had Moina at his disposal, and she did not want to play along. This game made all his problems disappear after spending all day dancing to resolve them. His problems basically consisted of deciding where to go party and forgetting the iron discipline of home. Everything in Tyson's life was perfect when he forgot about his family and sometimes without forgetting it. The same as for Moina. However, there was that unexpected look of Moina's that he did not know how to dominate. Something he was not used to seeing, as usually the whole world smiled at him. Moina had a big personality, or was as crazy as Tyson. One or the other or both at the same time. You can have a big personality and be crazy. In fact, many famous people possess both characteristics. When Moina threw him a hard look as if to say, "Who do you think you are?" it let loose the fury of the gods in the parallel world that Tyson had, where reality and dreams came together. It was an interference in Tyson's brain. In reality, it was as if they both had a brain wavelength that would resonate. And that's how it was. It was not that Tyson was irritated by Moina's stare, but that it totally changed the configuration of his world, at an unusual speed and on an unusual scale. Tyson could pass from heaven to hell in a matter of seconds. Moina was an extension of his own body. In fact, on an ordinary morning in those 80s years, he found Moina sat on the grass by a swimming pool of a mutual friend, and upon seeing him she gave him a cold look, even though it was Tyson that she wanted to see. Annoyed, Tyson thought, "Why does this have to happen to me?" Because Tyson lived quite well before this process that was happening with Moina. Moina did not usually do it, but when she threw one of those looks, the type that make people say if looks could kill, Tyson took them seriously because he was not paying her attention and he knew this was not good, and probably he didn't pay her any attention. As revenge for the pride that Moina displayed, when the whole world was laughing and having a good time with you in that scene, and somebody brings you down with a look, it changes everything and is as if you were returned to harsh reality. Even more so bearing in mind there lives in their different yet same families. It was torment. When he was in a good mood, Tyson fantasized about marrying Moina and probably she would have accepted, but he continued to be unable to find time to be with her. Yet everything was going at breakneck speed. And for two to come together, obviously they must coincide in the same space and time. But the speed of both must be equal or they were separate. One night, leaving the club, Tyson took her to his house with some friends. Tyson's mother even met her. In this way, time went by. One of the following nights, something inexplicable happened. Tyson was coming from a party, with his green eyes open and his pupils dilated. He had taken some drugs and Tyson's father gave him a sedative which he ordered him to take even though he was not a doctor. Tyson took it, went to bed, and his head exploded. He had an atomic bomb inside his head, in his family's attic room, from which he could make out the whole city with its lights and shadows. It was incredible. Ison had passed from being who he was to forming part, another piece of, the repressive system. Now not only of the repressive family apparatus but of the whole society. The following day he got up calmly, but something unexpected happened, although it could have been seen coming given the dictatorial nature of his father. That morning they locked him up in a psychiatric hospital. Although at first being there seemed like another game to Ison, there between walls thicker than those of the school he could not continue living the life he had. The possibility of perhaps never seeing Moina again was such a traumatic experience for Ison that it almost drove him crazy. There were strange people, and he was not able to pass through that thick wall that separated him from freedom, and that was worse than jail. Now he could not tear down that wall like he used to. In reality he was scared that he could be there his whole life without leaving, or that he could die trying to escape. He saw those whitewashed walls where there were people that had been there for many years, and he thought that everything would end between him and Moina, and that this was an irreversible process, that nothing could be done to revert the situation. He forgot that psychiatric world of people almost without hope of salvation, and he stayed asleep in his bedroom. The following morning he was already thinking about how to leave behind that wall that they had put up for no reason, but they caught him again and in he went. The following day he was planning another escape. In fact, Ison could have died in one of his escapes. On one occasion he threw himself from a fourth floor flat to get out of there. Realistically, if he did not die, it is because ultimately he had good luck. Ison knew that one way or another this would pass. In the preceding days he was scared of what his father's reaction might be. A few days earlier when he was with Moina he saw hunger in her eyes. Hunger to continue in the world outside of conventionalism. Then Ison realized that what she wanted was to live a life of freedom, in a way as Ison had done before falling. She wanted to have a kind of velvet cloth with which they would respect her. Ison had stepped off of that train, something for which Moina would not forgive him. Moina had been with him because in those moments they were accomplices on the same mission, but Ison now had the noose around his neck. Time had stopped and he did not even have a plan to face the situation. Although he did not believe that the branching of their paths and in general with the life and people with which he had lived until then was going to be so drastic, he did not have the strength to stop what was coming at him, and that left him a bit in the hands of fate. Or was it fate that played with them by bringing them together and now wanted to separate them at all costs? However, he sensed that Moina must have an inner life similar to his own, even though now she was acting brave. People normally like being with people who have a similar inner life, and although Moina hid it, she must have had experiences similar to what Ison was living through now, and although she concealed it, she was now going faster than him. As one of Ison's classmates had said to him jokingly, "Ison, you're finished. Sometimes you're up and sometimes you're down. See us live." In those moments the atomic bomb fell close to Ison, so to speak. It was as if there had been a radical change in his whole environment, transforming it into a deserted land. Moina was luckier, and although, curiously, It could be said that an era had come to an end in a traumatic way. There was always the hope that the situation could be reversed. Isan had lost the friendships of his old friends and had won enemies. With Moina he was in nobody's land. They went a while without seeing each other, and then they met in a cafe by chance, close to the ice cream place where they first met, where Isan went for breakfast with his friends once in a while when he didn't want to go to school. Isan was going to leave the cafe, where there were still echoes of those previous years, when he heard a piercing cry. It was Moina who had shouted Isan. He was astonished. She was as, if not more, good-looking, and he was in pieces. Isan looked behind him, something which he rarely did. The voice was sweet, but the circumstances had changed. Now nothing was the same. They greeted each other and after just a few moments said goodbye, as if before they had been nothing, as if it was an irreversible process in which they found themselves now. Moina knew what had happened with Isan. One way or another others had told her, their ways parted so easily, as was the manner in which they had met. Yet Moina was not humiliated by being in a better position. She was probably going through something similar. Isan started to work in one of the family businesses which had the wine in its sales. However, he worked unloading the lorries that arrived with the goods and he was paid very little. He worked hard and people did not understand that someone with a rich father would work. The same chancers that would end up in the ditch did not understand it either. Isan's situation was a total disregard for everything, partly because him and his family had wealth. At the beginning there was a good atmosphere and Isan even tried to improve his image with his father and his business partners by working. Who better than the owner's son to handle the ins and outs that moved the least desired parts of the company's work? He continued thinking about Moina, but all of the previous images became blurry over time, at the same time as the view he had of his father and his partners deteriorated as he saw that they were only pursuing their own interests. While it is true that during Isan's time in the family business it progressed and was very profitable, Isan began to lose interest in the job and to sabotage some of the things that he considered unjust. As the years went by, Isan had quite forgotten about Moina. He also did not believe in the family business as he thought that they would not let him progress and he considered that this was an irreversible process that negatively affected his personal development. However, when a memory of Moina returned to him fleetingly, his conscience reproached him as if to say, "Moina will never be yours, but you should not forget her," something as senseless as life itself. Isan was very bright and he started to study mathematics, skiving work as much as possible. Nobody in the department doubted that he was intelligent, and although in the first years he understood little, as with all of his classmates, as the years went by he gained the problem-solving ability characteristic of an exceptional mind. Now he did not even remember Moina. Sometimes the memory of her passed through his mind so fleetingly that it was almost impossible to even classify the memory. But his conscience was not able to accept this, and what his conscience demanded was as simple, or as difficult, as being separated, but without forgetting her. In the face of this heart-breaking outlook, Isan spent the day solving problems and teasing those from the arts, who he considered to be inferior. In the faculty he had a good time and they allowed him to tease them, presumably because he was intelligent. In fact, he only had his intelligence to come through this with, His brain was his most valued possession. He was going to finish his studies, from which he had won some friendships for life, but which time looked to separate. Wherever he went, he did not find anybody that occupied his thoughts as much as Moina did. Then something happened which, despite being unexpected, wasn't so much so for him, because to an extent his attitude had brought it about, and it was something that he desired: the end of the family business where he worked. The good and the bad spells come and go, and you have to be aware of when to pull out. Even the mediocre poker player knows that. You have to pull out while you are winning, because when you're losing it may be too late. His father's partner was a chancer. He spent all day on the phone believing himself to be indispensable. And the poor guy, rather than indispensable, was dispensable. He played the fool with Ison, as if he were above Ison. And the poor guy believed he was a winner even though he was a poor wretch. When the business closed, the motivation for which was losing an exclusive distribution of an important brand, in the following weeks he found himself without the important economic resources that the business has brought him. The smartest believe that good businesses last forever. Ison's father had pulled out in time. A timely withdrawal is a victory. But his partner was a neighborhood guy that only worried about what might have been. And he did not even realize that Ison's father was already 80 years old. The guy believed that Ison's father loved him like a son, and that he would still be working for him when he was 90 years old. How could he be such an idiot? In these circumstances, days before the business closed, it occurred to the employee, who must have believed himself to be a financial magician, to buy a house for €1 million. Even his wife couldn't stand him when he didn't have money. His wife asked for half of both of their assets, which effectively was half of the house, for which they had paid €1 million, and which with the crisis had dropped all of a sudden to 500,000. His wife even appeared on a TV program, Save Me, offering herself as a model to appear on the front page of Playboy. She even said on television that she would not sleep with anyone for money, which lets you envision her moral habits. She was a Balfit that had been lucky, just for the fact that Ison's father took her husband on as a partner. She appeared on Save Me because she played paddle with Kiko Kilovers, a collaborator of Save Me, like the new rich girl that she wanted to appear to be. The situation of this family became so chaotic from morning to night that the business partner's daughters even believed that their father was the boss and not an employee, and they could not go back to the private school where their friends were. Then Ison thought that with his actions he could come to handle processes as irreversible as these, where there was a story like Cinderella's, but this time in the real world and close to him. Ison had more than two brain cells, and it was not logical that the owner of the business, that is to say his father, could continue with the same rhythm at 90 as at 50. The employee was mediocre. In fact, Ison's father took them on like that, half illiterate, in order to have them dominated. To think that the life of the business was eternal could only fit in the head of someone very mediocre. Besides, Ison had power. He had moved lots of ins and outs of Madrilenian society, and he had lots of hidden interests of which it was in his interest to be on top of, especially with a father that was quite important, even though he did not even have a relationship with him. Then something happened that changed things for him. His dear mother died. She had been his only support in this hell. What's more, he finished his degree in mathematics, which is something that is very proud of. His main cause of pride was his intelligence. It was his dearest possession. He was not even interested in having too many possessions. His mother died in such a distinct date as Easter week, and as a gift she left €1 million to each of her children. Ison decided to live life, even though he knew that this was an irreversible process in terms of the money he spent happily. It was not a reversible process, and it would not return to his current account. He lived very well now. He was rich, and his elderly father, who he did not see now, was much richer, which would yield him a succulent inheritance in the future. In fact, there were some troubles with his father and even trials, because Ison had expected to receive more money for some concepts that were clear to him. Ison had forgotten about Moina a few years ago, but one day he got out of bed, the light turned on, and he remembered her. His brain would not allow him to forget her, although now he had no idea where she might be. He looked for her on Facebook and found her after a few hours searching. Although he noticed strange things, she lived in Kathmandu and the photos she put up were blurry. He thought that if there had not been internet, he would not have found her. In the passing of time between when they wrote to each other online, Ison wrote his first mathematics book. Another light had turned on again. 3 months on from that virtual relationship, he managed to get a date with her. Moina looked gaunt, to put it one way. She was now how Ison had been when the bomb exploded in his head when he was 17. She was no longer the attractive girl of his dreams, and Ison had a totally mathematical mind, far from the magical parties in the summers of their adolescence. It was February in Kathmandu and cold. At first the encounter was very emotional. They both went to eat in a residential district, but they got bored and went out to the terrace, drank wine, and smoked calmly. She smoked rolling tobacco and him his usual cigarettes. Upon saying goodbye, they shared an emotional hug. The next day he suggested they go to a hotel to enjoy a thermal bath, but she did not want to. Something had happened the next day that had also happened in their first meetings. After a beautiful encounter, Moina went back to giving him a cold look. Maybe something said to her that she should not go with Ison, even though she continued remembering him, similar to what had happened to Ison but 20 years later. He called her and she didn't answer. After wandering aimlessly through the streets of Kathmandu, he found her in a park with her son. Now it was nighttime and there was a big full moon. She fled from him until she disappeared. Although they had greeted one another, it was only out of courtesy. Ison left more broken than happy, thinking cynically, "Happiness is the last person that you find by the light of the moon." The process of his relationship seemed totally irreversible. Ison tried to redirect the situation, but it didn't work. His mind was focused on mathematics and she did not have the image that she used to. Perhaps something spurred on. Who knows why or by who. He understood very well what a reversible process was in physics. He had been very good in the subject where it was taught. The reversible process is something that can slowly return to its original situation. The bomb that makes a building explode is not a reversible process, because the building would not spontaneously reconstruct itself. But in life, if we go reconstructing our errors to just the opposite way, we can return to a prior situation that we longed for, he thought. Moina's cold look in the last encounter came back to unleash fury in the world of the gods of Ison. Ison kept going forward even though he could not get her out of his head. Bearing in mind both of their actions, there was something that seemed clear, as if both of them should not live together but without forgetting each other, something like modern love. That each should live their own life but with an affectionate ray of light that would make it more bearable. Now Ison only had to worry about managing the money that he had and would have, but after the last cold look from Moina he had a bad patch in the markets that almost ruined him. Economic security is not everything. You have to be an idiot to believe in something that only depends on probabilities. In fact, Moina thought that. She knew very well that probabilities are not certainties and that whoever thinks they know the truth 100% doesn't know what they are talking about. Besides, Moina's father was also a mathematician and gave probability classes. Perhaps that made her distance herself from certainties. Ison continued with his book that was being read more and more and helped people to feel better physically. It was a book between exercise and theory, something like a mantra of books. He laughed when he thought this. Obviously, they were not going to give him the Nobel Prize for it, but it was a good book. Ultimately, Ison and Moina tolerated each other, but they did not tolerate being close. It was like having each other without having each other. Ison went to Marrakesh, tired of this situation. It was a place to meditate about new books and play poker. To play poker is to take decisions quickly, not slowly. To have savings to deal with the bad times. To use your head and to imagine the unimaginable to win hands, and he did win them. In essence, it was to be smart. In fact, he was now very smart and lived at the expense of the casino, and his winnings even allowed him to save. He was like this for a full year, winning and living like a duke. After a year, he decided to pull out. What happened to his father's partner was not going to happen to him. That slacker who believed that the good turns were eternal. In this situation he met Admad, the hotelier in Marrakesh who suggested Ison invest in a hotel business. Ison was tired of the life that he led in the casinos and seeing that he could continue playing sporadically on journeys. In some casino in any part of the world, he realized that with everything that he had learned in the family business, and if he corrected the errors, and even compensated them with totally opposing decisions, then the business would work better. This started to happen. The business improved bit by bit and Ison became a businessman. That the business worked was the best way that there was for Ison to get his head straight, which was something that was worrying Ahmad. Between these changes of ways, Ison realized that it was for years since he had seen Moina and he decided to go to Kathmandu. He plotted the situation where a buyer would meet her to offer her money for some jewelry that she had. She lived far removed from any really urban environments and the buyer met her close to a forest of paradisiacal palm trees. Suddenly Ison and Ahmad appeared. Despite the fact that it was clearly a ploy, she did not look on it badly and Ison even met her second son. Even though the situation could be considered tense a priori, at that meeting the fury of the gods ceased when they met, and in fact the following months were unusually calm. Ison's business worked. The distribution of a family heritage was closer and his life was more stable. Ison realized immediately that they had reverted the situation. However it may be, that meeting, which could be considered as very amateur, had changed the situation. At that time Moina was with the waist of a man, a friend from when she was 20 years old. That man, who had no profession and was no benefit, tried to live from the bait that Moina gave him. This pathetic man saw Ison in that meeting. He looked at him moodily and quickly realized that he could not compete with Ison. Not long after that meeting, Ison and Moina went off the map. It was odd how the world that the gods manipulated had accepted that meeting and fostered that both of their lives would improve. It was also laughable that they were now older and had seen each other such few times in this life. The relationship with his business partner was unbeatable. Ison loved him. And something that he would not forget is that he helped him to find his soulmate. Although Admad and Ison were a bit homophobic, it could be said that they were in love. There were women sometimes, poker in some new casino in some city that they went to on a journey, a business. In fact, the virtual relationship with Moina was accepted and well looked upon by the gods that ruled their destiny and their dreams. Ison woke up one day and realized that he was closer to turning 50 than 40. Moina was in a similar situation. Ison also realized that 3 months had passed since their truce, after a life in which they had declared a mental war since adolescence. Going over his life, Ison recognized that he had already had an original idea and managed to establish the relation between physics and the human body, just before his first reunion with Moina. Perhaps it was an idea linked to his past as a defense. Perhaps it came from reading other physics authors, or perhaps something that Moina had inspired. The matter is that sports and physics had always been intertwined in his life, like that joke about Einstein and his wife on their wedding night, when upon seeing him she says, "What a physique!" It was not a new physics formula, but rather it was engineering applied to the human body, but that earned him respect. Ison knew that in this life they could take everything from you apart from the copyright of an idea, and that opened quite a lot of doors for him. Nonetheless, Moina did not enter into mathematical issues even though they interested her. However, she was an excellent mother, and although sometimes she put up a hard front, she was a typical romantic from a book, and underneath she had the ancestral idea that women have to be mothers when they grow up. Likewise, Moina had nothing. Although she had her children, these could be taken from her, as they took the life of a destitute person in any settlement in Colombia or Ecuador, and that made her vulnerable. In a way, she had Ison, but what would happen if he died? On a material level, they were both totally indifferent about having important possessions. They were tired of that lifestyle, and they also didn't like that type of life because of how uncomfortable it was, but they both knew what they wanted to do. Ison wanted to continue with his business, sometimes play poker, and continued writing physics books, without the intention of becoming rich. Moina wanted to continue being the mother that she was and to compose even more sublime melodies for piano, if such a thing was possible. The priori, it seemed as though they both knew where they were going, but now in reality they had a ton of questions. They started to review their lives. Memories came to them from different times, and at heart they felt an immense peace after having been fighting against each other their whole lives, in the same way as Ison and his father had been fighting, and he now tried to resolve things, a little as he saw that his death was imminent. Ison forgave him because deep down he was open-minded and he thought better late than never. Despite having an open mind, Ison was delighted at how lucky his father's business partners, rather employees, were, who in their day looked down on him as in the Cinderella story. Sometimes life is not a story, and Ison laughed when he remembered that one of them once said to him that he would not mind if Ison's father included him in his will. Ison wondered how the poor guy could be so stupid. The wretch had ended up selling cans of oil at fuel stations, and the poor thing was probably still going over in his mind whether he would be included in Ison's father's will. Ison had two ambitions. One was the economy and the other physics. In physics, time is a variable, as losing weight can be. In other words, you can say that you have eaten 5 apples to gain the kilo in the same way that you can say you spent a few hours to catch a plane to Kathmandu. We can use time in different ways, but to say we can control it makes no sense. Time moves forward, and Ison saw that his time with Moina was disappearing. Perhaps by dedicating time to her, the relationship could be rebuilt. Ison could not get her out of his head. If two people see each other in a train station, it is not enough to say that they saw each other and no more. We need information about what time or what day they saw each other. If they saw each other on a Monday, that is not the same as if they had seen each other on a Wednesday. If it was one day or another changes everything. Although it may be hard to believe, for two people to see each other, it is not enough that they are walking in the same direction and they meet. Their times have to go in the same direction. It is something as intrinsic as the earth we tread on. It is the fourth variable of space in 3 dimensions. Another song of a group that Ison listened to was the evolution of customs. Customs tend to change with time, and people are obsessed with this. They want to control time. What was clear was that nobody can control time. It is like controlling an atom or a tree. These things cannot be controlled. They can serve your purposes, but they are objects that are there and are not controlled. Ison thought, time is like a car. It can't join us together or separate us as it joined Moina and I now and as it separated us in the 80s. It is another variable of space. In fact, if Ison and Moina had not seen each other, it was not because they lived in different places. A plane to Kathmandu takes 9 hours. It was because the two of them had times that didn't coincide. Time is something intrinsic in every living thing, whether a person or a tree. It is an attachment like our spatial coordinates and influences our lives greatly. It is something like a part of our destiny. It can be used in different ways, but it cannot be controlled so that it stops in our preferred moments. If we use time in a different way, we radically change our environment, from our relationships to any other aspect of our lives. Ison understood then that if he wanted to improve his relationship with Moina, he ought to dedicate time to it. That was the issue. Dedicating time to certain things is important. It serves to heal your wounds and to keep your dreams alive. It was obvious that at this stage in life one thinks about death and whether there is anything beyond. If so, would they both be together? And if not, what was the point of this life? Ison wondered whether if after death they would find each other or whether they would be in different coordinates of time and space, practically like that had been up to now. That Ison dedicate time to Moina was risky, not because the time was wasted, Which is nonsense, because there is no such thing as wasted time, especially if it is dedicated to another person. But it implies that those people are living together in an intimate way. In fact, to not dedicate time to her is like living next to each other without seeing each other. It is like a wall that divides two joint rooms. It was curious how, when they were okay, a long time ago, Moira was interested in him because of her longing to be free and escape that network that pressed on her from all sides. And that Ison was in love with her, but with his heart, his head was elsewhere, not paying attention to the call of his own heart. Now that they both had nothing, they were interested in each other. Who knows for what strange reason? Life is very complicated, and whoever says otherwise lies. Well, the truth is that nobody likes. Most likely it is survival instinct, or that the solution is easy but the way tortuous. The only thing that we know is that they were mutually helping one another. There are many ways to help. A timely smile can prevent a cancer. Thinking about someone can alleviate their sadness. And even if they continued living in different places of the space-time maze, there was always room for a smile thinking about what they had lived.